Yo.
You probably know Cam from the Twitch chat, and we got Klisk. I don't know if he's got his mic on.
Yep. What's up?
Yay! And I think that's everyone in here right now. Some of our programmers are around, but they're not in this call. And yeah, we pretty much have no idea what we're doing. We just thought we'd do a stream and say thanks.
Thanks.
Oh my
yeah.
God.
Thank you guys so,
so
much.
Exciting.
Our extreme excitement.
Extreme.
Extreme.
Yeah, so I got the message that it was funded after looking at it all morning at work. I got it funded when I was out with my mum for lunch. So it was like the lamest. I didn't even get to get excited with everybody. I just had to say to my mum, oh, we got funded. She was like, oh, cool. That was it.
Yeah. It looks like we got the quality settings just now. So
the quality of your own stream that you're watching?
Yeah. No, I'm not watching the stream. It's just that people are getting a lockup. It usually does that little hiccup near the beginning.
Oh, got ya.
Yeah, that thing again. I wonder how long it waits before that kicks in.
As soon as it registers the amount of people, it'll be like, oh, you need quality options because you have enough people.
Yeah.
And then it'll kick them in, and if you're not running fast enough to catch up with it, it'll just freeze you.
Yeah.
Someone said, any bets on which one of these guys are drunk? I'm guessing nobody, because we don't have the stomach constitution at the moment to drink. Oh, yeah, Lauren's probably could drink if she wanted to.
But me, oh, I'm always drunk.
Yeah. Of course she's drunk.
Is that how you come with the bombs, then?
Yeah. Creative process.
Yeah, that's right.
Making sense now.
That's how the law's done so fast.
Yeah. Oh, good. Somebody mentioned the Mike Z edit in the
chat. Oh my god, that is the
funny,
I still can't get over how well that came out.
Why do you have
now?
I want to see what Mike thinks of that.
Yeah,
I haven't seen his response
I've been
yet.
Refreshing Skullheart the whole time. I want him to see. I can't wait.
Poor old Mike.
Today we learned that Omari and Mike have the same BMI, and that putting Omari's head on Mike's body works.
I don't know how that worked. I don't know. It's magic.
I'm not going to say I'm good at Photoshop, but I can do some stuff.
No, it looks pretty funny. I like the skin tone matching, too. That's how white
Omari's that's the main thing I thought would mess the whole thing up, but it really didn't. It didn't mess anything up.
No one seems to mind that much.
Good.
So next thing is let's get some Mac Linux going on.
Yeah.
All of this seems possible now. It's
crazy. It doesn't seem too far away, right?
Yeah, I think it could happen.
A goat would be pretty amazing.
Goat
I would very much love a goat.
Come on, goat.
Yep.
Goat, we'll please.
We'll have to see if we can get that far, I think, but I don't know.
Yeah, that could be tricky.
That could be tricky. Yeah. It could be tough.
That'd be
but
great.
I think we can get the Mac port.
Then Lauren, you can play it.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Plenty more people can play it.
See how terrible I am at fighting games.
Everyone starts there.
That's right.
Yeah. Gotta start somewhere.
I still think we should have could have added a fight Lauren in the game as a pledge reward.
As a team. I don't know, maybe that'll get us our goat if we put that in there.
Yeah, I have no idea where to put that, but if you're up for it.
Yeah, why not?
$35,000.
We will train you. Like a whole training montage and everything would be awesome.
Yeah, right.
Best music, it would be so good.
How much did Shaq Fu charge to have Shaq come DJ your party? We should charge that much.
I think it was like 35k or something.
Yeah, it was...
What?
Go check that. Damn.
It was something really high.
So, Lauren, what have you been working on in terms of lore? Where have you been?
I'm working on Paprika right now.
Oh, yeah.
So, I don't know if I'll get it done tomorrow, but probably the day after that. So, I don't know. I'm probably not going to have all the lore up before the fundraisers... finished, unfortunately, and I apologize for that.
Oh, you can just relax now, it's fine. So, like, you've already done it. So.
Yeah, I know. But, in fact, right before I came on here, I was scribbling down some notes and trying to come up with some ideas for the middle section. So, Paprika's next.
Go. And now, what do we got going on the stream? Who's playing who here?
I'm just kind of in training mode right now.
In training mode? Are you having set up the online-y type stuff? Yeah, we got to set that up. So, what else is going to go on in the stream? Probably not a lot.
Yeah, I'm really not sure. I mean, I was hoping to draw or animate something for when we hit 100%, but we hit it way faster than I thought we would.
I know, I left work about an hour and a half early as well, so.
Yeah. Like, I really don't know. I don't know what to do.
Okay, what can we do? Quickly, what do we got? I could play some Hearthstone. You could look at my iTunes library. Huh? Hey, look, there's Oleander. That's pretty cool.
That's a couple minutes of entertainment.
Yeah. We could have Lauren read out the Oleander story now that it's finished.
Oh, was that
full voice acting?
No, I'm not reading any stuff with dialogue, man.
Okay. Well, we could be the characters.
Oh, man. Really? No, you're going to do this now?
That's good timing.
Yeah, you could draw something. But anyway, it was really just we just wanted to stream to say thanks. I mean, I think we're saying thanks to the people that deserve it, because I don't think anyone else is going to randomly come onto our stream. So, they might do.
I think the main part of it is we wanted it to be a voice thank you, because over text it only seems so sincere, but when you hear the entire team say, "No, really, we appreciate it," then it's a lot more heartfelt.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, seriously.
Exactly. I mean, like, I can type thanks for your support, because that's kind of all I want to say, but I mean, you know. Yeah. But thanks for your support.
Sure, the sincerity.
Yeah. Thanks for your support. Really appreciate it. No, we do. It's been awesome.
That's going a bit far.
We more than appreciate it.
It's ridiculous. It's great.
Yeah, no, it's mind-blowing, and we're all very, very excited and very happy. So thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah,
and let's try
everything.
Try to get goats.
Let's see. The motivation, you know, the main motivation behind the project is to get it into people's hands and for those people to have fun. Like, it's all about that. So yeah. Now that it can happen, like, thank you from the bottom of our hearts.
Well, there's a couple of questions. So, were you guys worried that you might not make it? Yeah, I was.
A couple times for me, but. I don't know, I believe so strongly in this project and the people who supported it that I figured something at some point would happen. But even then, I was blown away that we got it this early. I thought it was coming down to the wire.
Yeah, it's everyone mentions the last minute rush thing, but that doesn't happen for some crowdfunds.
Yeah.
So it just doesn't. And some it does, heaps. And for ours, luckily, was one of the ones that it happened with. And people were waiting to the last minute and saw it was going to make it. And then they just pushed it a little bit more and helped out. So, and thanks to everyone who upgraded their pledges as well. That's, like, I don't know.
Every bit helped. Like,
yeah.
You don't even know. Like, every little bit helps. And it's all come together.
Was there a backup plan if the funding failed? Not really a backup plan. Really, more of a.
It's
well,
like either you get a publisher or the project is done.
Yeah.
It's just the harsh, cold reality of it.
Yeah, I mean, it was gonna. Without money. I mean, so. A lot of people have actually said, you know, why are you guys asking for this kind of money for this when you've been working on it so long for free? And it's sort of like, well, because we've been working so long on it for free. I mean, you just can't keep doing that. We can't keep asking people to continue to, or it's hard to ask someone to do stuff for you for free. Like, if we needed anything else, like we needed backgrounds done or we needed sound effects done, it's not just hard, but it's also kind of, well, it's unprofessional to say, like, can you just do this for free? Because we want it. It doesn't work. So we would have been stuck at some point if we kept doing this for free. So this, honestly, this just opens up everything. It opens us up to spend proper time on it, opens us up to schedule time on it, so we can actually have, strangely enough, so we can actually have breaks and not feel sort of guilty about, maybe I should be working on the game right now. It just enables us to actually put proper time into this and get it done so much quicker than we would have, to the point where it was getting to the point where we'd spent so much time on it already that I don't think it would have finished if we didn't have the funding. We can't continue the momentum for how many years?
Oh god, man.
Three, four?
I think it's four years. Well, alright, this project was like 2 years.
Yeah, but I mean, you've got to remember we've also 80% finished a game before this even started as well.
Yeah, that game was free. On the home stretch.
Yeah.
Real quick, sorry to interrupt you. Continue.
Yeah, no, I think we're done.
Somebody asked, so when are you quitting your jobs?
yeah.
For some of us, not all of us have careers outside of this. Like, I know I don't have a career. I've taken jobs before, but I don't have, like, a career outside of this. So a lot of a lot of my future relied on this going well. So Jay could quit his job. Jay, are you quitting your job?
No, I'm going to be doing it part-time. So I'm already doing it mostly full-time, and I'll just be taking a lot more time off to spend some quality time with this team. So I already have a job. I guess it's a career. I don't know. I never used the word career in my life. It's just a job that I like doing, and I've been doing it for 10 years.
That's cool.
So that's a different situation than a lot of people. So I'm very lucky in that respect. But yeah, I'll definitely be now having to talk to my manager and say I want to take a few days off a week to work on this. And he will be hopefully yes.
He'll be hopefully yes.
He'll be hopefully very yes.
And I'm 99% sure that Lauren is not quitting her job.
No, sorry.
Wouldn't expect it.
Lauren's work was very front loaded, so she's done most of her stuff already for free. She'll be still be working on the lore and new characters when we need her.
I'll be doing very tiny part time work on this, but. I'll still be providing character designs and turns and any sort of lore story work that we need as needed. I'm only available maybe one day a weekend, most weekends, but I'll still be working on it.
Yeah, man. We can't just leave you alone after all this now. Are we going to meet in real life? God, I don't know. I've met I've met most of these guys in Ohio at
Canelot Gardens.
Canelot Gardens a couple of years ago. Klisk sorted out some trips for us to go over and meet. So that was awesome, and that was in Fighting His Magic days. So yeah, it'd be quite cool to do another meetup, but of course, being in New Zealand, it's quite expensive to go to America. Yeah,
I think I've met everyone in this call except for Anu.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And Anu, of course, is stuck in Mexico. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. He gets stopped at the border. But now, he might be able to. So that'd be cool.
That's true.
Yay! Now we just need to get invited to conventions so that we can meet.
Yeah.
Let's go to Evo.
Let's go to Evo.
Evo would be great.
Yeah.
Evo would be fantastic.
Yeah, we going to
Lauren,
Evo?
You want to go to Evo? Lauren hyped up for Evo.
Do I want to go?
What that is?
Evo? Oh, I don't know. I've never been to Evo. I'll go to Evo.
Neither have I.
Okay.
First time for everything.
I think the only person who has here is Klisk.
Yeah.
Wow.
When I brought the old game.
Yeah, Lauren, you can bring a big sign with a salt shaker on it and just shake it and...
With a salt shake? I am not getting that. Oh.
It's okay.
Your training must begin, don't worry.
So it's a big fighting game tournament, basically. The biggest.
Oh boy. Okay, yeah.
It's very exciting. There's tons of girls that go, don't worry, you have heaps of people to talk to.
Actually, Jamie Lee Curtis was there this year.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, Jamie Lee Curtis was there.
Too. Yep. She cosplays Vega from Street Fighter.
Yeah, she did do that.
Outstanding cosplay too.
So Lauren, you can cosplay as Velvet?
What?
Do it!
Craig can cosplay as an elf.
As an elf? Very tall elf.
Just follow you around and sprinkle golden oatmeal on you. It'd be great. No, I understand what's happening, but it'd be great.
Super weird.
I do that all the time. So I don't know, meeting in real life would be pretty cool, but let's just wait until we've can afford some money. So the other thing is this is, you know, it's 436k. It sounds like a lot, but once we spread it all out, like, you know, we had to be very careful about asking for, you know, what would a normal game developer make? And then we had to say, so we have to then decide, you know, but we have to ask for an amount that is realistically going to get funded. And I mean, maybe now we should have asked for more, but, so yeah, it's not like we're going to be suddenly, flying private jets everywhere. We will just be able to buy food and pay rent and things now and work on the game at the same time, rather than choosing one or the other. So that is exactly what this funding has brought us. And that is awesome. It's a job now, so.
Can you even afford a single private jet on $436,000?
No, there's no way. $450 million. Yeah.
Yeah, they're a lot more than that.
Lauren's got one.
I was going to say, was that experience there? I felt a wave of experience wash over me there.
It was a very confident, quick answer. Yeah.
She only flies by private pilot.
That's true.
Yeah, it's true. Absolutely true.
I saw one person, since we were talking about EVO, ask EVO 2016, and that's probably unlikely. I wouldn't like to speak for everyone because, you know, I don't like any plans.
Yeah, it is pretty unlikely, yeah.
But we did say in the Kickstarter that we're aiming for an 18-month development cycle, and that's, you know, give or take if we have any problems. So having, like, a playable build at EVO this year may not be possible. You know, it's all up in the air, but I don't imagine it would be something that people should expect.
EVO is, like, middle of the year, right?
Yeah, it's usually early June, maybe the second or third weekend in June. July. Sorry.
Yeah, that's unlikely then.
Yeah.
It probably won't even be in beta, a proper beta by then, I'd say.
Speaking of beta, someone else asked, will there be Mac and Linux versions in the beta if we get that stretch goal?
Oh god, that's a good question. I think it depends on how easy it is to make that work and how we can simultaneously stream the programming work with the artwork on that side of things. It sounds likely, but I don't know enough about it.
I have no idea, but it sounds complicated to me, but I don't know.
We need our programmer dudes on the stream because they could just probably say, no idea, but yeah. It'd be a knowledgeable no idea.
Mm. Cam, do you know if Skullgirl's Linux version ever came out yet?
Oh, I think it'd be faster. Didn't they just announce the stream chat about that?
Has it been recent?
It was quite recent.
It would be super recent, and that was a 2013
stretch
IGG
goal
that they did. Yeah. That was like April of 2013, and that only happened recently. I don't know. Like, I'm not gonna call anyone out here. I don't know who was in charge of getting that done or when they started getting that done. But if it takes that long, then.
Yeah. I think it was the situation more so than the person. They had a lot more things to work on at once.
Yeah, someone said 2 weeks
ago. The short answer is I'm not sure. Because we don't know when the beta will be and we don't know how long the Linux port will take, so it's a double don't know question really.
And promising anything at this point is just asking for trouble.
Yeah, basically. No one's gonna want to promise anything that far ahead. Console version is, I mean, it really is a tricky thing to do if you're not developing for console on from the get-go. But yeah, we really want to. But yeah, that relies on a bit more resource than we have. So we'll just have to see what happens with the funding.
Sorry if I'm interrupting again.
Yes,
it says, I'm a nerd of Lab Zero. Have Main 6 ever considered promoting Lab Zero in each of your new projects? I think it would be a great PR and camaraderie between you guys. Actually, we have been on social media. We've been plugging each other's Indiegogos, you know.
Yeah, we also promoted them in at least one of the our Indiegogo updates directly.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, we're trying to. I mean, obviously, there's only so much we can do. We have a bunch of... because we can see the referrals, as you guys probably know, because we've got a referral contest going, and we've had a few referrals from the Skullgirls team. So that's awesome. Like, they've definitely helped us out. And, well, as a apart from helping us out with the engine, which was already...
yeah,
you know, worth about $10 million to us in terms of getting this game made. So,
but yeah, definitely, while we still have our own campaign running, and we appreciate more contributions towards that, we also do would like to mention that Lab Zero does have Indivisible going up.
And yeah, Indivisible is on right now, so...
yeah, it's...
but first of all,
they have
like,
what, 28, 27 days left on or something like that?
Yeah.
So it's still going for a good while.
That's right. Yeah, get us GOAT first, and then you can spend all your money on Indivisible.
Indivisible has 27 days, yes.
Well, there'll be auditions for voice actors, actresses and actors. Yeah, I mean, we want to do auditions. We want to do that as properly as we want to do the rest of the game. So we want to... audition. We're definitely gonna call up some of our old friends, but yeah, voice acting is something we need to think about. Well, now we can actually seriously think about it. So
yeah,
yep,
seriously,
pretty fun.
I know some people.
Yeah, Lauren's got some contacts. You can just airlift them in on the helipad.
I can fly them
on your private jet.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's the currency of Phonem called? Well, I don't know if we're revealing that.
It's super secret.
It's super secret.
It's not figured out at all.
Hey, maybe it is, Lauren. Maybe you haven't been part of those conversations.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yeah. Yep.
Mark Hamill is Velvet? Okay. That'd be good.
Someone said invite Mike Z to chat. If he wants, depending on how long this goes.
Yeah, he can come and chat. I don't know what he'd have to say.
I would love a live reaction to the Photoshop.
Oh my god.
Can somebody like so call Mike good. Z real quick?
Just Mike Z, he'll have a very he'll have a pretty stoic reaction, I'm sure.
If that's true and Mike like has said that he wants to talk with us, I mean, just have him contact one of our social media outlets. We can get like his Skype name and we can, you know, get him in here. I'm sure that'd be fine.
We've got him on Skype.
Oh, we do? Okay, cool. Yeah.
We've talked to him before, back in the days of early engine, and he was trying to explain everything.
I just didn't know if you still had his contact info. I didn't know how you guys...
oh, he might have changed it or blocked us or something, but who knows? I don't think so. Yeah. Well, what are we doing now? We're watching Nappy do some pictures.
Yeah, I'm just drawing stuff while you talk.
Nappy, why don't you draw a goat?
I don't know what the goat was going to look like. I mean, I know I drew a bunch of goats early when we first started, but I'm not doing that. Nobody's latching to any of my headcanon.
Well, just
Cree Summers. Yeah, I met Cree actually a few months ago. Cree Summers. She is pretty cool lady, and she has a really awesome husky voice. So I met her and her family.
Things about her. I've never met her though.
She's pretty cool. I learned to hula with her.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I wasn't very good though.
A while back, who everyone on the team is planning to main as the game comes out.
I main the random button. I'm designing everyone. Everyone's combat.
Yeah, Nappy's gonna know everything.
that's the issue, Nappy. You normally main characters with big meaty hands.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're not launching with any of those yet, so...
We don't even have hands.
We don't even have hands.
So I just default to everyone else.
I'm not sure if it speaks to my job as QA or just how good this game is, but usually when I play fighting games, my character selection is really, really rigid and small. But in this game, I enjoy playing everybody. I don't know if I can say I'm main.
That's a good testimony.
Well, I'm gonna go completely opposite from that and say that I'm definitely going to main Pom, just simply because Pom is my girl, and as soon as I can show you all what she can do, there's gonna be so many people on my bandwagon. Oh man.
Yeah, they're very tricky. Lauren, I saw a picture today of Pom, and it had, well, it was perfectly safe for work, first of all.
That's good.
And she had this awesome bonnet on.
Oh,
so
yeah?
I've got to say, it looked pretty good.
Style.
Because we started to think about Pom and Paprika with accessories. Because, you know, they're quite a lot of color in one place. So we've definitely been thinking about accessories for those two.
Oh, okay. A bell would make sense on Pom.
You can a bell, okay. With the dogs.
A little bell around her neck. Is that what people put on sheep?
Dogs can constantly keep track of her. She moves away.
And some people figured out the pompadour. Yeah, which is good. They love her pompadour.
She does have a
pompadour.
I didn't realize.
She does
that.
Have it. That's why we called her.
She's really into Elvis. She's really, really into Elvis.
Yeah, she loves it. That was why we put... I think that's why Pomp and Pom were on the list of names.
Oh, I was thinking of Pom Pom. Like
yeah,
a
it's a double. It's a twofer. It's a twofer one.
Hey, it just works in many different ways.
Yeah, how do you like that pun, Lauren? We thought of that one.
Hey, you guys are catching up to me.
Yeah, a double pun.
A question that I've been seeing a few times is, will you set up a funding thing in the future, maybe for stretch goals if they aren't met?
That's a good question. I don't know.
I haven't discussed this with you guys, but I've been thinking about that, and it seems like, you know, it seems reasonable to do, I think.
Yeah, I mean, if we stay completely independent, and we're kind of going to have to. If the game sells a bajillion copies, we might not have to, but I mean... Let's put it this way, you don't get into game development to make money. So, yeah, it's very likely that we'll end up doing a funding thing to get some of these stretch goals, or more characters will be probably the main one, and things like console things. Because we know six characters is a small roster, and we'd love, you know, a huge roster would be so cool. Look, we've got a Pom appearing already on the stream.
Her hair's getting even bigger.
What? That seems not. That's about right, isn't it? I guess it's quite long. It's quite long and square, that
pretty
one.
Long there, yeah.
Yeah. Tian Huo, still not getting much love. Why? Yeah, it's just It's just pure speciesism.
Yep.
Speciesism. If she's not a pure ungulate, people don't, you know, they don't understand. I don't understand either, because she's awesome. But yeah, no, Pom and Tian Ho are kind of like the least explored characters, so, in terms of what we've released, so, you know, the more that gets released, the more people will love them.
Yeah, the stories kind of are fleshing them out a little bit more and you know, giving a bigger indication of who they are and frankly how they differ from their predecessors. Hopefully people seem to be liking most of the lore so far, and I get a lot of comments, people saying like I didn't like this character before, and now I do. So hopefully that'll happen with Pom and Tian Hao as well.
I think easily. I mean, that's what happens.
I'm pretty confident in that as well.
as soon as you know anything about them, you can latch on and kind of start thinking of who they are and what they're like. And, you know, it's kind of hard from a couple of pictures to like a character. Do you know what I mean?
Or one picture. So,
or one picture.
Intense
and especially
case.
Non-moving. Yeah, it's why people sort of, obviously Arizona and Velvet are the most popular by far, just because we've just shown
yeah,
the most.
They're way more expressive.
And Oleander's getting up there as well, because we've got her lore out now and people have seen more of her on stream. In fact, it's pretty much, the popularity of the characters is almost directly proportional to how much we've shown. So if that says anything, I think it says that the more we show of the other characters, everyone will even out. Well, hopefully not even out. Hopefully everyone will have Longma the best, because she is the best.
Good save.
So I guess now we can actually start seriously thinking about setting up a backer forum.
That is right.
Yeah, we'll just need to figure out how to do that. And where we're going to do that. God knows. But we had some ideas, we just don't know exactly where we're going to go or how it's going to work or what's going to be on there. I mean, it's a backer forum, so for a while there might just be people asking questions and we'll try and get to them. But of course we'll use that eventually for things like feedback on the beta and things like that. When do you plan to begin the true timeline for game dev? Pretty much as soon as we can, really.
We might need a few mental health days.
Yeah,
probably very easily, yeah.
Yeah, and it's also Christmas coming up, so, you know, a lot of holidays and family stuff coming up too, so. But yeah, as soon as we can. As soon as we want to, really. I don't imagine it'll be very long away. I think we've still been working on little bits and pieces while this is going, of course. Yeah. But the thing is, while this has been going, a lot of the stuff has been focused on stuff that will help people understand the game. You know, in order so it gets more attention and people will help the crowdfund more. But now we can just sort of start focusing on, I guess, the more boring stuff, which is stuff that a lot of people won't see the result of immediately. And that's the stuff that drives game development, really.
We've definitely been working because we had to push a lot of stuff to have the game even presentable at Xanadu. That took a lot of last-minute work.
Yeah.
And before that, even for the Indiegogo in general.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Polish and polish as much as possible.
Mm-hmm.
I want to... If there's anybody who's either watching the stream now or... is watching the archive later who was at Xanadu, I want to thank you for your patience with us, because the build was pretty much as early as you could possibly show it and let other people play it, and they had a lot of patience with us with the hanging wires.
Yeah, and a lot almost of people have been asking why we wires. Don't just send the game to everyone to play, and that's kind of part of the reason, is it's hard enough to get it to a state where it will work when literally the developers are sitting there making it work, let alone just handing it to someone and saying, have fun with it. By the way, here's the 30 things that you can't do or that won't happen right or that might bug out or, you know. Oh, Lauren, here's one for you really quick. I don't know how long we got. We'll probably end up this thing soon. But Oleander's age in the new lore, what's up with that? Is she way older than Arizona or is she like unicorn years?
Yeah, unicorn years. I was thinking that the unicorns are probably more long-lived than other creatures because they're magical and stuff. so, I don't know.
That's the science behind it, yeah.
Yeah, there's totally science behind it. So I was thinking, like, in the story that I wrote, that she's still kind of an adolescent. She's, like, teenager-ish or something in terms of maturity. I don't know how... year-wise, how old she is, and that by...
It's not a phase, Mom.
And then 13 years from now, she'll be, like, a young adult. So, like, it just takes them a lot longer to mature and grow than other creatures, whereas Arizona's probably has the lifespan of an actual cow. So she might only be, like, a year old, or
So what you're saying is unicorns learn very slowly. They're a bit slow in the head.
Wow. Oh,
they must do. Must be, right?
Learn if they grow slowly. Okay.
Because Arizona seems to be doing pretty well for 1 year.
She is. Well, they mature very quickly, those cows. Yeah.
the future belongs to the young.
The very, 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 very young.
Very young.
Is Palm going to be younger than Arizona?
I do see Palm as a lamb rather than a full-grown sheep. She doesn't look like a full-grown sheep, certainly. So, yeah, Palm's very young as well, I would say. Those two characters, I think, are children. I think everybody else are adults.
Cool. So you shouldn't be hitting them in the game.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, why not? Hit some children.
Go for it.
They're threatening.
Yeah, I don't know what our rating is going to be on the ESRB.
It's honestly children. It's probably...
Yeah, R18 children violence.
I mean, Skullgirls got teen even with the substance abuse.
The substance abuse?
I mean, they had alcohol and tobacco. Like they had a child.
Well,
smoking
while developing
a
cigar. It, or oh right.
No. I can't believe you just said that.
I can't.
I wouldn't call it abuse. Substance use.
Yeah. Well, it's also the fact that Peacock is extremely young.
She's 11 years old with a cigar.
Yeah.
But also, that's all quite sexualized, that game anyway, so I assume that was going to hit like a... well, not sexualized, but, you know, they're clearly ladies.
What's that old video? 36E?
36E.
Is that... Okay. So, yeah, ours... Yeah. I don't think we've got any adult themes... In terms of that sort of thing, who knows? I mean, that's up to the pencil pushers to decide.
Yeah, I was just alluding that I can't imagine us being over T, but that's not us to decide.
Yeah, how does that work? I've got no idea.
Oh, PETA is gonna file so many complaints.
If I recall, the way it works with the ESRB is you send them a short list of some of the themes in your game. And you send them a short gameplay demo, and you send them a short video of different parts of the game, and then they review it, and they have a committee that judges what your game should be rated based on that. And it's a good faith thing. If they find out that you hid some content from them while being judged, like, you could be in deep trouble. So that's just a industry standard, you know. If you're upfront with us, and everything will be fine.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, I don't think we're going to have too much trouble with the ratings anyway. As far as would you call it a closed beta or an open beta? It's a closed beta, right?
It's closed. a closed beta.
Because it's back as
own. It's closed. Technically.
Some people have asked about, I mean, this is probably a terrible thing to ask about on stream because we haven't thought about it, but like, for Slacker backers, if people are slightly late, is there going to be any way to get into the closed beta? I don't know how we could possibly work that. I mean, the beta is an exclusive reward for the people who backed a certain tier. So, I don't know how if and when we'll open up, you know, do an open beta. But yeah, Slacker backers. How long will the closed beta be open for the $40 backers? I don't know. I guess from the time that it's a beta to the time it's not a beta anymore. Yeah. A bit too far away to answer that one, I'm afraid.
Will we be getting the keys via email? I'd imagine so.
Yeah, I think it'll use your email that you use for Indiegogo. But yeah, we can't. I mean, it's great that people are really interested in getting into the beta and things, but can't quite get the money together to back us. But I mean, we have to sort of keep it exclusive for those people that helped us get here, in the now, and that's just the way of the world. Um, Well, there's a couple of lore questions. I don't know, Lauren, how long you got? Or do you need to go and have dinner? How long, what time is it over there?
It's 8:45 for me.
Oh, okay.
I can stay a little longer.
Okay. All right, anyone got any good questions we can see in there? The dynamic music reacting to the taunts, or the T-taunts. Yep, that's something we are thinking about. But I mean, it is a fighting game at its core, so we don't want to sort of have everything be totally interrupted by, you know, a fun sort of taunt. But, you know, it could be something we do. We have to ask Stu if he wants to spend another 6 months doing that. Will we be able to buy the soundtrack separately from the Indiegogo tiers? That's, again, probably up to Stu. I mean, that'd be pretty cool, right? So, I don't see why not. It's not planned. Again, it's a sort of a far away type thing.
Here's a lore question.
Okay.
In our world, cattle exist because they are domestic animals and look the way they do because of selective breeding and inbreed. In Phonum, how did cattle come into being?
Ah.
A lot of inbreeding.
Well, I certainly didn't put any thought into it.
Lauren, don't lift up the curtain behind the wizards.
I didn't think that far into it. You know, you take liberties.
Yeah.
Liberties when you make stuff up like this. You can't, you know, these are talking animals. You can't apply all science to it to justify their existence. You know, I would just say that purely coincidentally, they actually did evolve that way. They landed that way through their own personal evolution, they ended up that way. Because there certainly weren't any people coming in saying, you breed with that one, because we want a specific result.
You want more meat on our cows, yeah.
Yeah, so they just ended
and
up...
And make them dumber, yeah.
Naturally, coincidentally, I would say.
Yeah, it's just luck. Yeah. Also, I don't think... I'm not sure about this, actually, but I don't think on our world there was a portal created to... send all the predators through. I'm not entirely sure because I haven't done history. But, so yeah, there's a few things that might not be exactly the same as our world, but just happened to...
up sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah. was that before or after Wounded Knee?
Yeah, I think it was right after that, yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
Hmm. That's why, I know New Zealand did it. We don't have any predators here anymore. Well, we didn't. And they, yeah. They got introduced. All our birds are flightless and walk on the ground and just lay their eggs on the ground and just go, there you go. And then all the cats eat them. It works out pretty well for the cats. What would happen if other races got a hold of golden oats? I think we might have gone on over this, eh?
Yeah, we did. I think we talked about this last time. I think golden oats only work on reindeer. I think they were... designed, and the magic spells that were put on them were meant for reindeer, so I don't think they do anything for anybody else. Maybe they give other animals really bad gas. that's
all. No ice magic.
Surely they are delicious.
And golden...
It just works on golden roots.
How long may it then? Does it increase their fire powers?
No, it undoes it. It makes it cold. I don't know.
Oh, that's interesting. Because it gives them winter powers, so maybe it would be very bad for a Longma.
But it only works on reindeer mitochondria.
It's a reindeer, I think.
Yeah. Does the $90 Menacing Shadow tier also have access to the closed beta? It's $40 up. If you've spent $40 or more, American dollars, that is, you are invited to the closed beta when we have one. That's right? I haven't said anything.
Yeah, that's right.
That was correct. Okay, yeah, good. Right. Damn, silence. Oleander turning black is seen as being corrupted by the other unicorns. Is it possible that all white unicorns are white because of light magic? And, oh god, where's it gone?
It's gold.
And changing color is an innocent byproduct of using different types of magic.
Reds and blues.
Are they only white because of light magic? And that all magic might have a different color to it. So the color changing isn't evil, it's just a, you know.
I don't know. I mean, that's a really interesting idea, and I think that's an interesting take on how to handle the lore of the unicorns.
It's like Green Lantern.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
I can't answer it right now. I think I would have to wait and see what the needs of the story are to define that sort of thing. Like, for now, all we really need to know is that there's light magic and that there's dark magic and that the dark magic turned Lander dark. If we decide to define it beyond that, we would, you know, I think I talked about this a little bit last time. The way I like to develop things is I don't really like to define anything until I have to, because something might come up later that you have to keep things kind of malleable so that you can address the needs of the story instead of working your story around, you know, something that you made up arbitrarily before. So I think that's a really interesting idea. And if, as we're working the story out, if something like that seems like the best way to go, it certainly could be. It's a very good idea.
Yeah, that's a great insight into sort of the general process of these things as well. I guess it's your experience showing through as well. Is if you start to define down all these rules and stuff very early on and really specific things, then you don't you've closed the door on a lot of things that that might come up naturally later. So
you can really paint yourself into a corner if you define.
Yeah, that's a much better analogy. There you go.
Yeah. You don't want to define too much soon, so that you can, or too soon, so that, like, yeah, if you reach a place where you go like, I really want this to happen, but we already said this rule, and now we can't do that. You don't want to be in that kind of position.
Right. Do the races of the world ever acknowledge how cute they are? If so, are they jealous of Pom?
Oh, yeah. That is excellent.
Nutjob EP, do you ever acknowledge how cute you are? You're amazing.
I'm sure there's plenty of people animals on Phonem that acknowledge cute things. But I can't imagine all of them do.
How much does each TFH character weigh?
Getting really specific.
I don't know. Oh, wow. Lauren, how did you not put that in there?
I know, I am not prepared at all for these questions. I have no idea. I would have to do some research on how much these animals weigh.
Yeah, six tons each.
Yeah, I I don't know. I don't have an answer for you for that.
How much does velvet weigh on the moon?
Yeah.
I can't believe you haven't even thought about it.
Get some money for the stretch goals to hire some, you know, mathematicians to work that out for us.
Yeah, I know. I love the specific questions because, I don't know, they make me laugh anyway.
What is each character's blood type?
I knew I was heading that way.
No, we're going to have to...
I was just thinking Street Fighter.
Yeah. Do you know about that, Lauren? About, like, the Japanese, like, blood type personality trait thing they have?
No, I think I may have heard about that once, but I don't know that much about it.
No, I don't know anything about it either. But, like, you'll notice in a lot of Japanese games, they'll list the characters, like, it doesn't matter what it is, like a fighting game, it's like, Heihachi, blood type, A, it does, like, Y. But they list it in the documents, because in Japan, there's, like, a blood type, I guess it's like a horoscope. You know?
Yeah, I was going to say, is that like saying your character is a Pisces or something?
Exactly. And then they go, oh, no wonder they're a jerk or whatever. So, yeah. So we could, if it ever releases in Japan, we'll have to do with their blood types.
We'll have to figure out their blood types.
X minus. Yeah. Just make up some new ones. What other species would you like to work to not just as characters, but to develop some story? That's a good question. Lauren?
What species would you like to work? Oh, I don't know. I mean,
You can do anything you want, really.
Yeah, seriously. It's like if we get to a point where we can extend the the roster out and bring in more characters, there's any number of well, we would be sticking with hoofed mammals at the very least. But you know what I think would be fun? But you guys tell me if it would be mechanically way too difficult. I think a giraffe would be really fun.
Oh, yeah. Oh man.
We put a lot of thought into that as well.
It certainly wouldn't be mechanically too difficult. Yeah,
at least half of us have already thought about and discussed how a giraffe would play.
How that would work. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
I think a giraffe could be a lot of fun. And then, there's lots of...
Because they got their cute eyes and everything. They got the eyes and the little horns. What are they called? Ossifications or something. I can't remember what they're called.
Oh, yeah. They're like oxycles?
It's ossa something because it's bone.
Yeah, but no, anyway,
let's not get too technical.
What else is good? Oh, you know what would be fun, too? See, look at me. I'm, like, bringing up the biggest animal. The tiniest little hoofed mammal out there, the dick.
Boy.
Someone mentioned having a dick in the game earlier.
Stop giving away all our
food. Yeah. We should actually give her our
internal...
Yeah. We're definitely on the same page.
We're just
going down the list at this point.
Yeah.
Before you said dick, I thought you were going to say poodoo.
A poodoo smaller than the dick?
I think they're very similar in size. I think a poodoo is like the size of like a chihuahua.
I think smaller.
There's also Guernics. Guernics. They're like somebody took a deer and then stretched everything out. They've got these long necks and these skinny toothpick legs. They're neat. They have them at the zoo in LA, and I am always kind of enamored with them.
I met a mouse deer. That doesn't make sense, but I saw a mouse deer. Well, no, I met her because it was at this this zoo theme park. I don't know who thought it was a great idea to put like animals next to roller coasters, but they're probably freaking out every day. But it was at Busch Gardens in Florida, and I got to go behind the scenes and meet a mouse deer that was like a surrogate mother to all the surrogate mother to like 8 babies, just random mammal babies that had come through.
Uh-huh.
So she was a legend, and her name was Samantha. And it cracked me up for some reason.
It's funny.
It was like, "Hi, Samantha." Yeah, and she was just this mum. She just loved being a mum.
Everybody's like, people are bringing up all these great animals here.
Yeah, we can't use any of them now. Thanks, guys.
I know. Yeah. Okapi, rhinoceros.
Rhinos would be pretty cool.
Yeah, rhino would be really cool.
I actually want to try
Oh my god, moose would be so fun.
A witch, Anu?
What are they called? The vampire deers, the ones with huge fangs.
I think they're just called a fanged deer or something, or a really good name like that.
Yeah
fanged deer.
But a Z-donk.
Z-donk?
It's a hybrid between
zebra donkey?
The donkey.
Apparently zebras are like incredibly violent. That's why you can't keep them. You can't keep them.
Yeah, that's why people are
everyone's like, "Oh, they're just horses," and they're like, "Nope, they're horrific." Yeah. Well, let's just say with ungulates, we have a million things to choose from. Being the
camels. Yeah. Yep. No, there's lots of really cool stuff.
The biggest order of mammals on Earth.
Yeah, I know. There's too many of them. Tapirs. Those guys are
tapirs, they're cool.
Has to be a female tapir though, for certain reasons.
Really?
You guys can look that one up. Yeah.
Look that up.
You don't look it up.
Take it upon yourself to look it up or don't look it up.
Let's just say there's a reason that you don't see male tapirs in zoos.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had no idea. Have to look that up.
Yeah, just look it right up.
I don't know.
Yeah, you can look it up. You can handle it, Lauren. Seriously, like, it's so exciting talking about extra characters we can make. So, I mean, we've done this conversation many times.
Uh-huh.
And, yeah.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about domestic animals yet either.
Yeah.
Someone said, can we expect a Phonem world map?
Maybe, someday.
Reminds me of Middle Earth.
Yeah, that's right. What about small horses? Have you tried those? I have. Delicious.
Wow.
Isn't that funny, yeah? It's like, oh, you ate a small horse, and it's like, I'm just going to have some burger now. It's fine. It's just, cows are fine. Just kill them and eat them. It's fine. As soon as you say you eat a horse, everyone jumps on your back.
I live in Mexico, so...
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Sorry. And wasn't there a big thing where, like, half of the meat was horse meat anyway somewhere? And I can't remember.
I thought that was in the UK. Like,
was it in the UK?
didn't they use horse meat in the UK when there was a mad cow problem? Like an outbreak?
Probably. I don't know. I know they use it in cat food and stuff all the time. Which for some reason makes me laugh that cats are just eating horses. I don't know why. It shouldn't be funny, but... Yeah, Lauren, can you give us an impression of what you expect Fred to sound like?
Oh, geez. I can't give you an impression. I'll tell you who I was thinking of when in his normal voice, not in his I'm trying to be scary voice.
Oh yeah.
I was thinking of this comedian named Andy Daly. Is anyone familiar with him?
Yes.
He has this fantastic show on Comedy Central now called Review, and my husband and I are obsessed with it. So I was thinking of Andy Daly when I was writing that stuff.
I'm going to look him up and see if I can recognize his face. Is it E? No, just Daly. Daly.
I think it's D-A-L-E-Y. I'm not sure, though.
Yeah.
He did a voice on my husband's show.
Oh, yeah. He looks very familiar.
He was on...
Eastbound and Down. I know him from Eastbound and Down.
Yeah, he was on Mad TV 100 years ago when I was young.
Yeah. Same here.
Yeah, he did perform. And he just plays, like, really friendly, kind of nerdy guys.
Ibbish.
I was thinking of him.
Okay, there you go.
But how it ultimately turns out, who knows, but that's who I was thinking of.
Ask Jay to do an impression of each character of the game. Oh.
When I read the lore, and I heard, I was reading the Fred dialogue, it reminded me, I read it in the voice of, there was a live-action movie for Discworld where they had a character that was Death, and I think he was played by Ian Richardson.
Ian Richardson?
And
I was thinking Stephen Merchant myself.
Oh, Stephen Merchant.
Actually, someone brought that up on 4chan, so I was like, I'm in love with that idea. What audience did you initially want to draw to the game? I don't know if we really aimed it at an audience, did we? Not really.
Just ourselves.
Just ourselves.
We kind of did what we thought. I mean, what we thought, what we knew we enjoyed, and anyone else who enjoys it, I guess that's.
We were hoping that.
We weren't really aiming it at anyone.
We were hoping that enough people would like the same things that we do that we'd be able to get enough support.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question because you kind of. It's hard to just. Focus on an audience, really, because I think then it almost like the thing Lauren said before, where you just end up painting yourself into a corner. So you do what you want to do, and then it'll find its own audience, really. Like, if you like it, then it's going to find its own audience. Of course, you could, you know, a lot of movies obviously don't take that tack. They just make everything PG-13 just to get the most money, but we certainly haven't been trying to do that on purpose. Although I don't think we're going to have everyone swearing their heads off and violent
fatalities or anything. Or, yeah. No.
Well, the other thing was, because we started with Fighting as Magic, and we knew that we didn't want to alienate sort of the intended audience of that show either, which was, you know, a lot younger people, and so we didn't sort of make it over-the-top violent or have anything really... have them even, you know, be super mean to each other and stuff like that either. We've expanded a little bit on that now. We can. But no, we didn't want to sort of make it too unfamily friendly, like with fatalities and things. Fatalities.
Ugh. God.
Yeah. I know. I don't know why I said that.
It seemed like a good idea at the time.
Did Daigo really give a shout out to your game at some point? I don't know. If anybody can link that,
I'd like to read that one, yeah.
I don't speak Japanese, so I wouldn't know.
Yeah, you might have.
Like,
I'm unaware of this.
Yeah.
I know with the old project, Marlon Pie gave us a shout out one time.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, yeah, James Chen is probably one of our biggest advocates right now.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I forgot to see what his reaction was when he actually crossed the finish line. He was very excited. Oh, yeah.
James Chen and Ultra David have been plugging us almost every single week of our campaign, except for like 1 or 2 weeks where they were busy with other stuff.
That's right.
Almost every single week of the weekly podcast, Ultra 10 TV. They broadcast every Tuesday, sometimes Wednesdays when they can't meet the Tuesday date on Ultra 10 TV on Twitch. And they've been really supportive.
It's been great. Well, it's funny because we've got a funny sort of audience out there. Speaking of audiences, because we've got the connection to My Little Pony, which is obvious. Like, it's an obvious connection. It's a direct connection from what we started to what we are now, but also the fact that sort of legally we have almost nothing to do with My Little Pony. Like, we know we don't have any characters that are in the show. The only thing we've got in common is Lauren Faust is the designer of both things. So we have a sort of a strange Venn diagram of fan bases that we're trying to combine a little bit. So I don't know. Hopefully when the game actually comes out, people will take it for what it is, which is a fighting game, and not not be so reactionary to just how it looks. And we really appreciate sort of James Chen's shout-outs because of that, because I think he helps to sort of just say, look, it's just a fighting game, guys. It's looking good and it's looking competent. And I don't know. I really appreciate it personally.
Someone said, are you going to try to encourage a competitive scene for the game? If you don't mind, I'd like to give a little bit of input on this.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
Even though I'm a member of this team as a QA, I'm still a competitive fighting game player, so I'm very familiar with the FGC in general. And the way the FGC works isn't like a typical esports community. They tend to latch on to whatever game people are playing at the time, and if they can find a group of people to play it with, they will. And I don't think we're promoting a competitive community out of the gate per se. But if the support is there and people start playing it, we'll definitely, support them however we can, whether it's just moral support or, what have you. But that's entirely up to them. I can't imagine us making like an esports style league, because fighting games don't really have that kind of system set up for them. But if any place people want to congregate and play TFH, they obviously get our support for giving the game a try and taking it seriously.
Yeah, it's one of those things in the FGC that just sort of happens on its own, but we'll definitely support it, I'm sure, if it does
happen. It's very hard to force or sort of control that, and you don't really want to. You want it to develop naturally, and if it starts to become competitive, then as Klisk and Oreo said, like, it's our job essentially to, well, it's not our job, but we'd really like to support it and help it, wherever we can, so. And if that means trying to bring builds to places that we can get to, and yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's a 1v1 fighting game. It's going to be competitive at some level. We'd love to see that turn into a scene, if that makes sense.
One person really quick just said nobody brings PC to fighting game tournaments. That is not true. Skullgirls for a while had the most recent update on PC, and I remember going to NEC and there was at least a dozen computer setups running the game, and that's why we ran that tournament. And then there's always at least one person with a laptop in the hotel lobby that's running like Third Strike on emulators, and people could just sit down and play.
Yeah.
Alty Blood always ran off of somebody's laptop in the anime room.
Yeah.
You're right. If it is on consoles, obviously it's a lot easier because you can just bring the disc and just shove it in. But I mean, it being on PC doesn't preclude it out of the gate from being brought to these things. How did we get started on our path to developing games? Could I find someone with technical skills to help me create games I envision, or should I save up for classes? Honestly, I just want to be the character store lore designer. Story lore designer. That's someone's question. If you want to be a character and story and lore designer, it depends what you want to do. Like, if you want to get paid for making games, don't ask us, because we haven't done that yet.
We're just starting that whole journey.
Yeah, but if you want to just make games, there are plenty of forums and things of people who would love someone who could write a story, and or they can just program, and they want someone to design, help them design characters and stuff. Like, if you want to just get experience and try stuff out, just get out there and start asking. I think taking classes is a pretty good idea, but I don't know of the credentials of any of the places that do game design courses. But definitely getting skills, like if you want to be an animator, obviously learning 3D animation or 2D animation and stuff at a class is pretty good. All this stuff is learnable by yourself on YouTube and things like that. But a class sort of gives you that, I don't know, there's a lot of energy in a classroom situation a lot of the time with everyone else trying to learn and learn from each other. So I don't know, I recommend doing something like that. I did a multimedia course myself, and that sort of started my whole path of animating and things like that. So
on the flip side, I animate for this game as well, and I have never taken an animation course.
Mm-hmm. I've never taken an animation course, actually. I've just taken a software course. Oh, okay. But that let me sort of get confident enough to go, oh yeah, I could do this properly, you know, I know the software. But I've got a lot of friends who work at movie studio Weta, who did like Planet of the Apes and Hobbit and Lord of the Rings and stuff, and a lot of those people did sort of 3D animation courses and things. So it's just different for everybody, but yep, look around out there and start asking people if you can help out, and yeah, it could turn into something like ours did. I mean, it only took 4 years, but or whatever it is, but you know, it happened.
And even if you can't find anybody, you know, keep looking, and in the meantime, practice, you know, do things that make you excited, think of some ideas.
There are always places where you can learn the skills for game development in a controlled setting. I remember Unreal Tournament used to have something called the Make Unreal Contest, where they would ask you to make content for the game, and if they liked it, they would not only put your things in the game, but also offer you a scholarship to go to school to learn how to make more game assets. So there's always developers out there that are trying to take budding game designers who are working on mod content and take their talents and either bring them onto the team or give them the tools necessary to give back to the game dev community.
And in general, if you want to be creative, you kind of have to do it for yourself, so you should just keep doing it, keep practicing.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Oh, Lauren, here's a question for you really quickly. Are there any herbivores in Fonum that are not ungulates?
Oh, totally. Animals that are not ungulates are just that. They're animals like they are on our planet. So there are herbivores like rabbits running around, but they don't talk. They don't have personalities. They just hop around and eat grass and flowers. Any... Just the other animals in the world are all, you know, they're all herbivores, but they're not sentient like the ungulates are.
Cool, there you go.
And that's
On the same, there's another question before I noticed. It's sort of like, what about predators that are kind of like not a threat to ungulates so much? Like a, you know, scorpion or a stoat or something like that.
I don't know. I think I'd have to think about that one.
Let them live.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's a toughie. Because they're not a threat.
They're not a threat, really.
They're not a threat to the ungulates, so there's no reason for them to get rid of them. So.
Yeah, like cute little snakes and stuff.
Yeah. The big snakes, they all went away.
they go straight to the hold.
Yeah, the boa constrictor,
no question.
Pythons, the anacondas, they gotta go.
They gotta go. They're right out.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I'd have to think about that a little bit. But since they're not a threat, I'm inclined to say they got to stick around.
Having just killed a scorpion a few days ago, I disagree. They are totally a threat.
Yeah, they're totally a threat? Okay. Well, I guess... But they're just going to sting you. It's fine.
I would lock camel spiders in the hole.
They poison you and kill you, but you don't die. They don't eat you, so...
Yeah, it's not their fault. They don't eat you. It's just eating. Yeah, they can just kill,
yes, the eating
kill you
part
all they want.
Yeah,
they didn't mind. Lauren. Your
yes.
voice is so cute.
Oh.
That's what
someone well, thank said. You.
Oh, I didn't know if that was a comment.
I wasn't saying that.
Okay,
I
didn't
know.
I
know.
I mean, like, are you gonna say?
I would
you
never
tell
say
me
such
I
a
sound
thing.
Cute now, Jay? Like,
no, just Lauren.
Am I being left out?
Lauren,
what
is
music
cuter
have
than
you got
came,
going,
Debbie? Hello, Nappy.
Hey, what?
Oh, people that don't know or just joined, this is Amari drawing at the moment. Nappy.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I was just concentrating on the drawing, but someone asked me a
question. I know, yeah, you're not saying anything. No, I don't think you... Oh, something about the music, or what music have you got going?
Oh, it's just the idle music of the game in the background.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Can we see inside Oleander's book? No.
That was pretty dangerous.
Yeah, I don't know if you want to do that. I mean, you'll see some of the frames here when Nappy's playing. You can see the book open up. It's yeah, we will need to work. We're thinking about ways to simplify that pipeline of drawing the book, actually, because it's kind of like a, what do you call it? I was going to say man-made object, but not really. It's sort of a more regular type object that we might be able to do some tricks with in Flash.
Don't Eldritch Tome tropes typically cause insanity anyway when you read them?
I think so. Yeah, she should just go around telling everyone to read her book.
That's the best fighting move.
Yeah, she wins immediately.
Homework. Homework is her fighting move.
Yeah. Yeah, Palmer's rocking a pompadour, that's right. Da-da-da. Can you get other members of the team on a stream? Yeah, we'd love to. I mean, this is just, we've just been doing a couple of things with whoever's around. Yeah, we'd love to do some other sort of game dev type stuff on stream. We'll definitely do that now we've... Oh yeah, now we've been funded. By the way, we got funded, guys. How cool is that?
Yay!
Oh man.
I feel like I just want to relax rather than get excited. It's just like, oh, so good.
Oh, it is just beginning.
Yeah. We still have 3 days to go.
Exciting thing.
I think 3 days to go.
It just begins after that point, too.
We just got a tweet congratulating us from Yomi Gaming.
Awesome, thanks.
Oh, Yomi? Is that Ceylon?
No,
Yomi Gaming.
Yomi Gaming is a team from Atlanta. They're known for Mortal Kombat.
Oh, Yomi!
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Thank you, Rose.
That took a second to click in my head. I know that name.
Yep.
Didn't they have a Smite team at some point, too?
They might have. I don't know. All I know them for is their MKX. They have really good MKX players, and they have a community down there in Atlanta.
Yeah, I think they've been trying to expand into other games recently, too. Cool. That's really cool. Neato.
Oh, here's a good question about some technical stuff for the funding is or for the crowdfunders. When are we going to start sort of talking to people about their OC characters to put in the background and accessories and things? I mean, obviously not quite yet. Well, when are we, guys?
I'm not sure. I mean, I guess we want to actually finish a background first, so we can start testing that stuff, but...
Yeah, it'd be nice to have a game before we start getting into the polished stuff. Though I guess that really comes down to Anu, because he'll probably be doing a lot of the collection and organization stuff for acquiring all that information, so I don't know how much of a head start he needs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think it will be immediately. It will be at least a few months until then. Realistically speaking, for most of the rewards.
Yeah, yeah.
The thing with the rewards is that the physicals have to be sent at all at the same time, or mostly at the same time. And they are not being sent until the end of next year, probably. So, yeah, it's still a while to go.
Yeah, physical rewards still a while to go. The other one is, we could also sort of start getting some data early on and then try and spread out the work on things like the lobby accessories and the OC characters and stuff throughout the development. Like, you know, it won't just be all, okay, it's Monday, let's do, you know, 100 lobby accessories. We'll have to try and spread it out. So, I mean, some people might be early on in that process. Some people might be later on in the process. But it'll all get done in time. Someone asked a question about something about refreshes, but I'm not sure what it was.
It was about the limited tiers. And they are kind of sold out.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, the limited tiers are limited because that's what limited means. They're limited due to what
reasons.
The people... Yeah, due to reasons. So if it's, for instance, the plushie tier and stuff, I think we've recently grabbed another one, right? Because our plushie maker, who is... username?
One person, Buttercup PPG.
Buttercup PPG is the username. It's just one person, yeah, so she has things to do in her life, as well as making plushies, so we can't just sort of say open it up to 20, whatever like that, so they're limited because they're limited, and you know, there's only so many refreshes we could do. Okay, let's do one more question, and maybe a bit more drawing, and then some of us are going to have to go. And yeah, this was just really a thank you. Sorry it wasn't more exciting to stuff to look at, but it just, yeah, thanks. Thanks so much. Oh yeah, the prototype Arizona from Buttercup is looking pretty cool, huh?
Seen
those pics. I hope you guys have seen those pics.
You can drop links in the chat, right?
You can if you're a mod. If you're not, it'll get bodied by Moobot.
Okay, Lauren, before you go then, here's a question. Really simple one. I think it might have been asked before, but it's what made you decide on a Longma?
I'm sure most of you know that this, you know, everybody here knows that this game was originally Fighting is Magic, based off of My Little Pony. And, you know, we had to sort of reverse engineer our characters to fit all the excellent animation that these guys had already done with the Friendship is Magic characters, so we needed a character that would suit Rainbow Dash's fighting style. So we needed a character that could fly, and we needed a character that could, like, send out, like, projectiles, because Rainbow Dash used to have her sonic rain boom. So we went digging into the internets and doing some fantasy research, and we came across Longma as a magical ungulate, half horse, half dragon. The dragon aspect of it included fire, so between the wings for the flying and the fire for the projectile fighting, it just was a perfect fit. So
yeah,
We retrofitted her to replace Rainbow Dash's fighting style, but she doesn't have Rainbow Dash's personality, just her fighting style. So there's my answer to that.
Perfect.
With that, I think I'm going to give my goodbyes for this evening, and send out a great big huge thank you to everybody once again for funding the game, for showing us your support, for spreading the word, for getting us to 100% a few days early so that we've got a great shot at getting a stretch goal, maybe two.
So thank you so much, you guys. And it's just like super awesome just to see so many people supporting independent artists. I think that that's super important and just makes me, restores my faith in humanity. So thank you guys. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and thank you. And thanks everyone on the team as well, because we couldn't have done that without any one of us not doing stuff over the last few years. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's still sinking in, the whole funding thing, to be honest. So.
I still don't know how to even. We're
not used to being able to sort of not worry about it, to be honest.
This lack of worry is alien to me.
Yeah.
I expected tears and I've just got relief.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, Lauren.
Alrighty,
thanks. Farewell.
Good night, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.
Okay, nope. Lauren is gone.
Yeah, you probably could have done this without me, actually, but that's okay.
I want everyone here, man. It's appropriate.
It's a high level of excitement. I tried to wake Oreo up from a nap because of this. Like,
it's a shame that we couldn't get Beta and Ken and Stu and Whitetail in here, but
yeah,
this was really last minute.
Yeah, that's okay. The programmers and Whitetail don't generally get on the streams anyway, but they do check it out.
Yeah. Stu's usually chilling in the chat with everyone else anyways, in the Twitch chat.
Yeah, Stu usually comes on and tries to say questions to me.
Is it cool if we answer a few more questions? Because I saw a few.
Oh, I don't mind, man. It's only like 5:30 p.m. for me.
Okay.
It's 12:30 for us. So 5:30 p.m. for us anyways,
yeah.
Right?
So,
pretty accurate.
Let me answer this one real quick. Where is RC88 from? He is from the UK.
He's in Wales, if I'm not mistaken.
He's from Wales.
Yeah. Someone asked, will this game have GGPO?
Yeah, yes, dog.
This game already has the version of GGPO that Skullgirls shipped with, but you know, when Rising Thunder showed their trailer, it mentioned a newer version of GGPO, and if that is enough of an improvement, we're definitely looking into that as well, because you know, the net code in a fighting game has to be as good as it's humanly possible due to just the nature of the genre. But definitely.
Yeah, so if there's anything we're not going to skimp on, it's
good online play.
It's the experience of
just
the
whole
play.
Online
yeah.
experience.
Like, it seems crazy
is super
that you
important.
Wouldn't use GGPO.
If I'm not mistaken, some of the core funding took the licensing fees for GGPO into an account because we didn't want to make it a stretch goal. It's important
absolutely.
Enough to be part of the core
funding. Oh, yeah,
it's
100% compulsory to have GGPO, in our opinion, for this game. So.
Yeah.
Someone's asking, will the game have controller support? In its current state, it already pretty much accepts any controller you can plug into a PC at the moment. Like,
yeah.
We have many different controllers being plugged in. Nappy's hitbox, my stick, Oreo's pad. Like, Klisk has several different of each of those. Mm. It just runs with it. And that's another thing that Skullgirls was really good in general with. They just accept pretty much everything you could throw at it.
Yeah,
I'm pretty
right.
sure if we got, like, Gonos.
That's one of the benefits of being on PC, to be honest.
Mm.
I would say almost anything that a Windows PC would recognize as a controller, it will run, more or less.
Yeah, pretty much.
You could play this on like a Flight Stick Pro or something.
Yeah, the DDR pad is the one that comes up.
I've been playing on a Super Nintendo controller just fine. I mean, pretty much everything you want to use works.
Klisk, I don't know how you hook up all your controllers. It's ridiculous.
Klisk is the hardware.
It's what he does.
Yeah, it is what you do.
Yeah, I have like 3 USB hubs right now.
God damn.
And each one has 12 ports and they're mostly filled.
What?
Yeah.
That doesn't cause like voltage problems or anything?
I'm just imagining smoke rising from
there. The problem is just like a tower of
It's a huge desk space problem, but most of the hubs are going directly into the PC, so it doesn't really cause too much
power. Are they all like powered, like externally, or are they
They're all powered.
Okay.
Someone said guitar controller. I remember watching a video of somebody playing Devil May Cry 3 with a Guitar Hero controller.
Did they double trigger by like tilting?
They had it synced. It did actually trigger Devil Trigger by activating Rockstar.
Oh man, that is so good. Oh, wow. I need to see that.
Oh, hey, here's a question for you. Well, actually, it's for all of us, but it's mainly for Nappy. It's Hero, and he asks, "You plan on a more traditional grappler in the future, like you know, Geef start?"
Excuse me. I'm honor bound to create a grappler. Yeah. As a future character. When we first started the project, I actually kind of wanted to have the grappler included at the beginning, but it's a lot of work just to get these six characters in. So definitely a grappler as soon as possible in the future.
Yeah, I mean, remember that these are based on the analogs for the old pony characters, and there wasn't really any that kind of... I mean, that kind of would have been a good grappler, I guess.
I had at least 2.5 designs for grapplers, but yeah.
Yeah, the grapplers would definitely suit future characters, absolutely.
The way the question was worded, though, it said traditional grapplers. I'm not sure exactly what that entails anymore, and not to be facetious, but before Blaze Blue, Iron Tager would have been considered a non-traditional grappler because of the pulling mechanic, and
right.
even Zangief's redesign.
Even Zangief became Tager in Street Fighter V with this vacuum.
His new mechanics are considered non-standard.
That is so weird, but I love it.
Red Cyclo- I remember watching the video of it as people were talking about it, and he just turned really big and red and pulled Ryu towards him, and I was like, I'm already scared. Like, you don't need to show me this anymore, please.
That's the only grappler that I don't use, and once I saw him in Street Fighter V, I have to use him now. He just looks so silly, but I love it.
Yeah, also, so grappler definitely at some point.
Yeah.
Pure grappler. Someone asked, does it feel awesome knowing you can just make the game with no worry now? Yeah. It's like I said, it's still sinking in for me, personally.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Bella is another good example of a non-traditional grappler with the run and the run-through cross-ups and the flight.
With the everything that isn't a grab that Bella does.
Yeah, Bella's such a cool character design.
Yeah. I love Bella. So much fun.
I think the evolution of those grapplers, it must have been just a... It's obviously a natural evolution because people just, people get better at these games, the grapplers become less and less viable, or what?
Well, as the games get more and more...
Depends on the systems that are involved in the game.
That's right. Then the grapplers only have access to a few of those, I imagine, just because of their pure style, so...
Fighting games have been called spectacle fighters before, and it's really kind of true. As timeline goes on, games seem to be getting more flashy and more mechanically suited towards...
Complex.
Not really complex, but diverse, I guess. So as these new mechanics get added, the characters that aren't grapplers get stronger, and in order to balance everything out, the grapplers have to get stronger with them to counter those new mechanics.
Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, it's just a natural evolution that the pure grappler gets, you know, less and less... I sort of see what you guys are saying there. Someone asked me what my job was. I'm an animator illustrator for a e-learning company.
You're also apparently Solid Snake.
Yeah, that's my text message.
Thanks.
It's just a really cool job. I've been there for 10 years. It's great. And that's why I don't want to just quit it and make games. I want to at least, you know, stay on and do both of them part-time.
The way the economy is now, man, some people need two jobs.
Yeah. I mean, my role in this project sort of has been getting smaller and smaller and more specialized as we went on. Like, the first few months of stuff of Pony Game, it was great, I'm going to be able to animate all this stuff, we're just going to have three animators, it's going to be awesome. And same with Neppy and mainly Neppy.
I thought I was gonna animate anything ever at all. And
yeah.
Then, nope.
It's been mainly Luke, Leiden, animating just about everything while we sort of are the ones that are taking care of other things that we were skilled at. But I mean that's what happens in these teams. It's pretty sweet. So I think the soundtrack question's been answered, but like the soundtrack is not completely backer exclusive in terms of maybe to be downloaded later, but it is backer exclusive in terms of, I think, the physical copies and things, and the digital soundtrack may be released later, I don't know. It's going to be backer exclusive at least for the foreseeable future.
Nappy, how long have you been drawing this?
I started this like the other day, and I just remembered that it was up when the Metal Gear.
I thought so.
I wanted to draw this for freaking weeks, though. Really frustrating.
Yo.
Just to tell a really terrible joke.
Did you see my really terrible joke?
We haven't fully designed those dogs yet either.
Nah.
I can't wait till we've sorted this out.
Can I have a copy of that when you're done with that, Nappy?
Yeah, sure.
Alright, sweet, thanks.
The music is going to be directed by Stuart RC, and so I think at some point, you know, it'll be his choice to decide how to work that sort of stuff. We want the backer exclusive to be pretty exclusive if we can help it. So, you know, it's you guys that have made this possible. You know. So, well, assuming you guys are people who backed, you know.
Backed, spread the word, etc.
Yeah, spread the word. Yeah, exactly. Stuff like that. I mean, that's there's no way around it. That's the only way this was going to happen. So.
You've been getting hype, right? You know, channel the energy.
Yeah, man. God, I'm speaking of hype, I'm sort of getting too relaxed now.
I'm really happy with all the Metal Gear Solid 5 references going on in the chair right now. Keep them coming. Yeah. I support every single one.
Did anyone say Big Boss yet?
I started it. It's kind of my fault.
Yeah.
But
and then my text message put it over the edge.
People are shouting out who. Somebody said Kaz Tiago Miller.
Such a lust for revenge.
Who?
Who?
God.
God.
That line delivery is the greatest.
Played us like a damn fiddle! Oh!
We built it. It was ours.
You can't get us started on that. Hype needs to go into overload. Honestly, it's, you get hype for a little bit, and then you're just like, finally, like it's like you've been holding your breath for a while and now you don't have to. So it's kind of a strange reaction to not be all hyped up and things, but it's we also did that when it hit 100%, so don't worry about that. We were very excited.
Somebody asked what kind of conversation are you going to have with your employees?
Employees or employers?
Employers. I don't know if that's a reference, or I don't know if they're talking to us. I just saw it go by.
Are we talking to our employees right now?
Maybe just like, our game got funded, so do we have to quit now? Same thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, guys, what are you going to tell your employees? Okay.
Oh, half of us don't have any, so...
Yeah. So this is going to be the job for most of us. I'm just going to say, I'd like to get some extra time off every week and work on this, please. And then they'll probably say, okay. It's not going to be very hard.
Yeah, I'm talking with my employers right now.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Pretty much. I mean, that's why I was concerned when it was talk with your employees. I mean, this is what we talk about, though.
Yeah.
You jump into voice chat with us, and it's just, somebody just mentioned MGS5 or anything else. It's all a very calm and relaxed environment, which is probably the only kind of environment you want for any project at all, ever.
Once the IGG campaign is done, will there be more opportunities to dish out more money to you guys in the future?
I don't know. I think we mentioned this before, but I mean, once we've made the game and we put it on Steam and all that sort of stuff, we have plenty of ideas for more stuff, and how we're going to get that money is kind of going to be up to us, like whether we make it all from, you know, sales of the game, or the game doesn't sell and we just have 20 people playing it and having a great time. We could do another crowdfund, who knows? So we just don't know. I don't know if we're going to open up like a full-on just donation type thing.
We're gonna have to check the legality of that first. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know if we. I don't know. It's we don't know. We're not worried about that right now. Anyway, we've got our budget for the next, you know, year and a bit. So, yep, that's good for now. Does this relax?
Someone asked why $100 and $90 tiers are separated. I'm pretty sure that the $90 tier was, yeah, it was either that there was a digital only version of that one rather than having any physical rewards, but there was also an early bird kind of thing where it only had a few of them at that price, and then the price went up as well.
Yeah, the $90 tier, the Menacing Shadow, is a digital version of the $200 tier. So you get all the digital rewards from the $200 tier and none of the physicals.
Yeah, I mean, and the reason we did that is just purely because physical tiers cost us a lot to produce. So the more people get digital tiers, the sort of the more of that money goes straight to us rather than to rewards.
And it's also
who
don't want the physicals as well. Like some people.
Yeah, exactly. Because some people not in US, like me, for instance, would have to pay an extra a bit of money to get the shipping. So, and because that can be a pain, it can be something that they can get for that sort of amount of money. Like they want to pledge about $100, but they don't live in the US. That gives them an option as well.
Someone asked, "Do we own the IP?"
Yes, the company owns the IP.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Whoever asked it, yes.
Yeah, yep.
That was kind of the point of making things fighting first. We can do whatever we want with it.
Yeah, it's all ours. There's no one above us or really below us. It's just us.
Someone said, can't wait for the best friends to play this. I saw that Wooly said he would be excited to try it on his Tumblr.
Yeah, I saw I saw it pop up a couple of times in their subreddit, because we sort of check for any mention of our game, and it popped up a couple of times there, so obviously they must have mentioned it a few times, so that's cool. I can't wait for everyone to play this. It's going to be great.
Yeah,
watch people playing it.
I'm really blown away by how many people are interested in the game from all walks of life, from, you know, both the gaming community and just, you know, people in general seem to be really latching on to the idea. That was cool, because we weren't sure at first if the idea would resonate with people. You know, it's always up in the air. There's no way to gauge if your ideas are good.
You spend all these years working on something, you never really know until you finally unveil it. It's like, hey, there's this thing I spent, you know, 2-4 years working on. How you like it? It's like crap.
Always the fear.
Yeah, like that's it.
But everybody seems to be really digging it so far.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've mentioned this before as well. It's really cool to see people just getting interested in the lore and the characters. And I honestly am not one of those people who gets into lore and characters of fighting games. But this is just... seeing everyone get into it and sort of being a part of it, it's got me a lot more hype than I ever thought I could be about, you know, like, I can't wait till Lauren uploads the lore and I get to read it first. It's like, oh my gosh, what have I become?
People grow, people change.
That's right. But yeah, if people play this game and they just are interested because they're interested in the characters, I think that's a totally legit reason to play a game.
I mean, it's great to have multiple ways to enjoy a game.
Like, yeah.
Just why not make sure at least a good amount of your game is good enough to kind of stand either on its own or just complement the other good parts of it.
Yeah, that's right. it's also a lot of the impetus for us to get this lobby in as well, and to make it a bit more featured, you know, than might be necessary, is because we know that a lot of people who play these sort of things will get a huge kick out of enjoying the game in that format, if that makes sense.
Yeah, the game and its world, its characters and all that stuff. Like, it's completely understood that, you know, not a lot of people will probably, you know, stick around purely for the fighting game aspect. We'll just, you know, just have something for everyone.
I mean, yep. Even as like a serious fighting game player, some days you just want to sit back and be like, I don't want to take it seriously today. I just want to, you know, mess around. Yeah. So options like the lobby are a good place for, you know, so you don't have to take everything so seriously.
Yeah, that's otherwise, right. You just have
remember
a.
Remember, they are options too.
Yeah, yeah. Options. Usually there are no options. It's just you go into a lobby with a bunch of names and you watch people, like watch the same seven people in a cycle. And then skip your turn. And that's it. Yeah, that's usually what a fighting game lobby is.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, you can do a bit more of that. So why not?
We're on the front page of Indiegogo, so wheat.
Wait, we what?
Yeah.
On the front page of Indiegogo?
Oh yeah.
Nice. I'm not surprised. That last push was just crazy, you guys.
Oh yeah.
Just awesome.
Being able to sit and watch the last $6,000 just roll in.
Every time that number changed, we were like bouncing off the walls.
It was an audible gasp from everyone as the numbers changed.
Oh yeah, it was just nuts.
I wasn't worried.
Yeah, everyone except for Oreo. Oreo was just chill. Like, come on.
I probably looked at the crowdfund page about five or six times since it started. I just barely updated
it. Total?
I
watched it five or six times every 2 to 3 seconds.
I don't know. I just thought it would be either fine or... I was super relaxed about it up until the last sort of day or two.
Come on now.
Five keys, but
come on now.
I'm serious. You guys just kept me updated with it, and I was like, oh, that's cool. We got last
day. I think the rest of us were just tapping F5 over and over.
I know. Yeah. I know. That's what I mean. It's just it's an interesting. I don't even have it open right now on my browser. Oh dear.
You're weird.
Yeah. Yeah. That's.
Nappy, if you're going to keep giving that palm drawing more work, draw Fred as a philanthropist in the back.
Yo. Do it. Yeah, oh,
I was actually going through all the characters and seeing where they would fit, like, but like, I forgot to write it down. That is actually really, that is really good. That is really good. I need to write that down. I'll do that in a bit. But I have no idea how to draw it.
Giant mecha Fred.
Yeah. Wow, that'd be so good. Oh, that is so good.
You can see it in your head, can't you?
Yes, instantly.
Oh, man. Oh. Get back to us on that.
Okay, so we should probably, we'll close up soonish. Well, maybe nowish. Okay, bye. No, maybe not.
Yeah,
just right now.
Yeah, I don't know.
Because we still got stuff we got to talk about. And, yeah, we'll do a proper... this was just kind of a bunch of just no one knowing what they're talking about. But we just thought we had to do something and just say thanks. And we're saying it to you guys because I guess the only people that are going to know about the stream, like I said, are people who probably know about our game. So, we want to stream... We're not just going to stream for crowdfund. We want to stream as we go. We don't want to overdo it, so just have streams of the same thing all the time. At some point it might just be very relaxed-y sort of things. If we've got anything special we want to show off, we'll sort of make note of that and do a special stream, like, you know, when artwork for a character is more completed or something like that too. But we don't want to saturate everybody with to overdo it, basically.
Oh wow, I forgot I drew that.
But yeah, streaming is definitely not going to just go away when we start working on it. Um,
Oh, not everyone's trying to find an analog in Metal Gear for our characters. Capricus Chico.
Man, I gotta play this damn Metal Gear. I'm so behind good. On games. I know. I'm so behind on games.
He's so good. We don't talk about Chico. He's absent from Phantom Pain.
I've got, like, no time. I find I've got no time to play games properly anymore. I need, like, little games that are just, like, little matches and I can leave it. Yeah, like Hearthstone.
Metal Gear is rough because you're like, I'll play just for a little bit, and then suddenly you've spent 4 hours in Afghanistan.
Yeah, just wandering around.
Just playing.
Stealing
this is gameplay.
Drivers in them.
I'm too old.
Oh my god,
I dropped the toothpick.
Because you said, oh, I need to make more time for games, and all I thought was, there's a lot of games coming out.
I know, I end up buying them and playing them for like 4 hours, and I'm like, oh, I'll play that again soon, and then it's... Oh,
and then
shit.
You never, yeah. That's what happens when I play single-player games, except for Metal Gear.
Shoutouts to the people who backed us, who are looking forward to all these great games coming out this year and next year, and who said, no, I can definitely pay for another.
Yeah, really.
Yeah,
that really means something.
Because as gamers ourselves, we know that there is
a lot of shit on
the way. There's so much stuff, and they've all got huge fan bases. And you decided to give us money too. Like, thank you so much.
Yeah,
that's huge.
Thanks so much. It's just awesome. Someone mentioned something about comics, and oh my god, we'd love to do.
I would love to do. It takes a while, man.
It takes a long time. So, one of the ideas was even to do comics for the lore updates. And we thought, oh, we'll do a little comic for each lore update. And then it's like, you realize there might be a comic every, 4 days. Oh,
yeah, that
okay,
wasn't
it's,
happening.
It's just not going to happen.
It was so much work just to get the 2 or 3 images that showed up on every lore update.
Yeah. I tried making a comic for Arizona, and I mean, I can't really... Look at it, but like, it takes ages. As soon as you involve more than just the character being talked about, you have to design, whatever character they're talking to, design just backgrounds and all that stuff. It's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. We've pretty much got the team you see here, and a couple more programmers, and our music dudes, and that's kind of who we've got. So. Everything that we have put out has been spread out somehow between the resources that we have sort of right here. And it sounds like, it'd be cool to see, a comic a week or something. Just a small thing, like a comic a week. And I think people really underestimate how long all this stuff takes. But man,
it's not a small thing.
And so do we sometimes, because we think, oh, we'll do this and that. But we've got a lot better at that over the last, how many years? Yeah.
Too many.
So, too many years, yeah. So, I mean, if we had made this game, 3 years ago, I think we wouldn't have been as realistic as we have been now. So, yeah, we've learned a lot just from doing stuff. Hey, Mike Z might be coming.
You're pretty
really?
Good.
Who say that? Why say that?
Do we have confirmation?
You might be getting here late.
Yeah, who just come in and be like,
or just... just closing out, but
that's cool.
I still want to see.
It'd be cool to do a stream with those guys. God, I don't know what we even do, but
I don't know. Trying to figure what out.
We should. Yeah, like this should be something we plan. I mean, it'd be nice if he was around when we did our random impromptu stream. But I think it'd be better to try to get a few representatives from both companies to just sit down and have a powwow, stream it. That'd be fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't talked to those guys for ages.
I'd like to talk to
not
Bender.
Not on voice, anyways.
Not on voice, yeah. Yeah, emails back and forth and stuff. Mike Z!
Mike Z, who, by the way, is running their own crowdfunding campaign right now.
Yeah, Lab Zero's got their own thing going on. Which looks beautiful, by the way. And also, I want to steal all their tech that they used in the engine.
Particularly the backgrounds and how
they have
the little, all the platforming elements. Crew back. Oh, whoa. I actually have not seen the Mike Z emote.
Yeah, what's ESD Mike Z?
Yeah, you have to be.
Oh, it's 86.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I somehow have not seen that one yet.
Yo, 86. Lab Zero versus Main Six on a Skullgirls tournament? I don't know, man.
I don't know, man. That implies I play games or something.
Until I lose.
Yeah. I mean, like, what's the numbers of the teams? Are we gonna do pretty like, much full, be like full Oreo. Roster? Or are we just like gonna pick who's actually gonna win here?
Yeah. I don't think I'll be entering that tournament. To put it that way.
Oh, that's 86.
The 86 account is actually in here. Oh. Dang, I thought somebody was just hearing things wrong. Wow.
No, that's who posted the Mike Z.
Oh, I didn't know. I just went straight for the icon, didn't even read the name.
Yeah, fantastic.
Shit. Wow.
The Z engine. I know, the classic Z.
I just want
Z
to apologize again for the image. I'm sorry.
Actually, I wonder if we can reveal this now, but a lot of people asked about, like, why don't we just do something small like t-shirts as part of the pledge rewards?
Yeah, I totally was talking about that earlier with the chat.
Yeah, it's very expensive. Like, pick a number and then add a zero to it, and you're probably still not quite there.
Yeah. Like, add
a zero to the end, not the start.
We pulled the shirts, like, pretty much right before the fund went live, and I was sad because... Yeah. I drew this image for the tier, and it amused me quite a bit.
Oh god, it's the Mike Z cat.
What's that?
You can show it.
Oh god, there's another Mike Z. It's the cat! Oh god!
We really need to get partnered so we can get some sick-ass Twitch emotes. Yeah. Like,
I want some emotes.
That.
But the other thing is about those t-shirts, because I think the reason was because for a crowdfund, we couldn't just kind of go, here's a t-shirt, here's a t-shirt. Here's a t-shirt. We had to go to a company and say, we need 2,000 t-shirts. And then it turns into a big thing. After we're funded and once we get our game out there, we'd love to do stuff like that.
Oh yeah, Nappy, show them the Steam brand, please.
The what? Steam brand?
Oh yeah, this thing. Yeah, that's another thing. We couldn't promise any Steam beta access until we were greenlit, so we never used this either. I was kind of proud of this. You know, it's just a little scribble.
I like it.
Oh, the Steam brand.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not really cool to use corporate logos to companies that we may not be affiliated with before we have their permission.
No, I mean the one with the cow, man.
We're not.
I know which one you're talking about.
We're not in CA.
Come on.
Lauren's in CA. Wait, CA is, that's the correct, I'm thinking of California, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, Lauren's the only Main Six member in California, I think. Oh, wait. Clue? I don't know. But, no, I think we're all over the place. We're not really, we don't have an office, by the way.
Yeah.
Like,
we
don't have an office.
Real quick breakdown, me, Luke, and Omari are in Maryland, as well as Whitetail. Cam is in Canada, Klisk is in New Jersey, Anu is in Mexico. Lauren is
in New Zealand.
Jay is in New Zealand. Bundles. Yep.
Yeah.
All over the place.
So we don't have an office. I mean, that we would need quite a bit more money for that. So we're doing this in our bedrooms. But I think, where's our official company located? Is it Delaware or something?
Incorporated in Delaware. Delaware, yeah.
Yeah.
We're located in Delaware, but our office, quote unquote, is our post office box.
Yeah. Yeah. Ay, ay, ay.
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, 86th. That's not a very exciting answer. Well, actually, it's way more exciting than just being in California.
Damn.
Whoa.
I don't know, Californians have a lot of pride. I mean, that.
Well, yeah, but if we're all there, that'd be just so boring.
Wow.
It's more fun having, like, random...
I mean, like, I like snow, so... I'm kind
of... Yeah, I like cold. I almost died when I went to Florida. Holy crap. So warm. Yeah, stretch goal office. $1 million for a nice 7-room office would be great.
I've already heard from Anu that if we get an office, I got a window office.
Wow, you claim dibs already?
We had a discussion about this, and I'm pretty sure Anu's response was, yeah, everybody gets a window office.
Was I part of this discussion?
You might have been. I don't know. I can't remember who all shows up in these calls anymore, man.
Whatever.
The past month has been a blur. You know this.
It really has.
I'll take the office without the window so I could put up black lights.
Damn, that's such a Klisk thing to do.
All right, well, we'll close out really soon. Thanks again. I mean, how many times can we say that? Lots.
Never enough.
Yeah,
we've still got 3 days to go as well, so I mean, yeah, we shouldn't be relaxing. Hype for GOAT. GOAT.
Oh, that'd be the best.
Yeah. Well, hang on a minute. I just thought of something. Are we still supposed to deliver the GOAT in the same time frame?
I don't think so.
The stipulation was just that it would be free to backers whenever it came out if we reached that stretch goal.
Oh, okay, yeah. Thank God. Oh,
but if we're really good with our time, we could totally do it. But that's that depends on so many things going right in a row that it's just impossible to really promise.
Yeah. So, okay, we might do another stream on the official end of the campaign, but I don't know what it will be. Maybe we'll just do another sort of more planned one where we think of some stuff to do. I don't know. We'll definitely do some other stream soon, though. Otherwise, everyone go to sleep and dream about playing this game. That's probably what we're going to do, except we'll be dreaming about making it. And thanks so much. It was ridiculously fast at the end there. Thanks to everyone who linked us and sent, annoyed all their friends and all that sort of stuff. Shared us on Facebook, shared us on sites, shared us on forums. It's literally because of you guys, that we're here. So, hooray.
Yep.
All right, guys. See you later.
Good night.
So panic, really panic in 10. Narn.
Server. 6. 5.
I don't know when it turns off.
I was just waiting for you.
Yeah, I think we're waiting on the countdown.
He's slowing down. Wait. 0. Do it!
0.
Kill it. Kill it.